thank you all for taking time out of your busy schedules to come and talk about this important piece of information and initiative that we have going with retention. This is a co-sponsored event with Faculty Senate, so we're going to start with Faculty Senate, and then we are going to start the form. Do you need to...
We'll go ahead and do this. You're here for this business. We'll do with Faculty Senate at 3 o'clock.
Okay. Okay. So anyway, we want to thank Faculty Senate for co-sponsoring the event with us. CORE is the Committee on Retention Efforts, and we're going to talk a little bit about that once we get started, but I would like to first ask President Perry if he'd like to say a few words.
Oh, wow.
Hey, we're high tech here.
American Idol, here we go.
It's for the podcast.
Okay, okay. For the podcast.
All right. Well, I want to thank everyone for being here today. I'm very gratified by the attendance. Retention is an important issue for all universities. I'm glad we are embarking on this effort to really look at retention in a data-driven way. Certainly when I speak with alumni, I get a lot of great stories about their experience here at Eastern and how a faculty member or a staff member made a huge difference in their completing college and in their life. And that's a defining characteristic of EIU, that kind of personal relationship that gets developed, and it makes the big difference. I mean, one alum who said he had messed up on an exam. This is back when you still had landline phones in the dorms. And the professor calls him and says, I know you come talk to me. So he did, made a big difference in that person. And he says, I can give his name, is Tim McCollum. You know, he's a graduate. He's just retiring from the schools this year. He helps teachers all over the country through an NSF grant. And that professor and that call makes a difference. I've talked to alums. And I said, you know, what was the important thing for you at Eastern? And one person said to me, well, you know, I was a student worker there, and I learned great life lessons about punctuality and professional behavior and all these kind of things. So it happens in many different ways. Clearly, it's an academic issue, but it's a personal relationship issue, too. So I am very pleased to have this effort going on. I want to thank everyone who's been a part of it today. I want to thank all of you for your participation. I want to thank the provost for his initiative and effort in moving this along. The story I tell to prospective students, and I just did that this morning with some of these students who are here for the engineering and science competition. They were in the food court, so I stopped and talked to their coach and these two students. I said, this is the place where you get personal attention. This is the place where you got great faculty and staff concerned about success for the students in their best interest. And that's the story we have to continue to not only tell, but live. And these efforts are going to be important for that. So thank you very much for being here. I'm going to get back to Old Main and do some things that I need doing. We're going to be in Springfield tomorrow making the case for Eastern. So thanks again, and I'll give it back now to Carl.
Thank you, President.
Thank you.
And now we're going to hear a few words from our provost, Blair Lord.
Thank you, Carla. I don't know how many words of welcome you need to hear. You got the president, now you got the provost. One of my job descriptions is keep it succinct. I, too, want to thank Carla and Kimberly and the Faculty Senate for jumping in and co-sponsoring this. This is probably the largest turnout for such a forum that I can remember in the years I've been here. Someone will say I'm wrong, but it's certainly one of the largest turnouts, so thank you all for coming. I know that many of you think the last couple of years I've probably been a one-trick pony. Talking in the academic affairs arena is focusing on integrative learning as a way to realize the goal of being the best at integrating the academic and personal development of students. This year, at least some of you, certainly the deans who've heard me with regularity, have heard me start to talk about a couple of other themes, and they are the two R's, if you will, recruitment and retention. One starts to have major themes at some risk, because if you have too many of them, you have none. You have to keep the list very finite, otherwise people can't figure out what they need to be spending their time on. But there's no doubt that while integrative learning is still a pinnacle centerpiece of the academic agenda, helps us talk about the quality of our programs, that we also need to be paying particular attention to recruitment and retention. Retention is important because it's important for our students to succeed while they're here getting their education. They come here hoping to get a degree, and if we don't retain them, they can't achieve that goal. At the institutional level, it's also important to think about retention because we need students. We attract students, we try to get students, we try to help them accomplish their educational objectives, and we need them, because Eastern without students isn't a whole lot of an institution anymore. Retention then becomes important for our students, and it becomes important for us as an institution. And for both of those reasons, I've been talking about the essential need for us to pay attention to retention, and something we've talked about for a long time. But as the challenges in the world around us become ever greater to attracting and retaining students, we have to put a special focus on that. And so I'm pleased to see everyone here today to talk about that. Retention, as the president alluded to, happens with students in all of their various interactions around campus, and we can't always anticipate what the key interaction will be in allowing them to say, this is a place I want to come and this is a place I want to stay. So it becomes sort of the job of everybody to help focus on retaining the students that we have attracted, helping them find ways to stay connected to Eastern and to achieve their goals. So I want to thank again Carla, Kimberly, and the Faculty Senate for co-sponsoring this, and all of you for being here. Thanks so much.
We just wanted to hit really quickly on what we hope to accomplish this afternoon. We want to provide some information, but then what's most important for us this afternoon is to have a dialogue and a discussion and some to generate some ideas amongst us.
Okay, so what is CORE? The Committee on Retention Efforts is a joint committee from Student Affairs and Academic Affairs folks, and we have gotten together for the past few years, spent some time looking at retention data, graduation rates, why do students leave, why do students stay, and we have tried to focus on things that are going to make our students more successful and become graduates and then happy alums. And so we're going to share some of that data with you. A couple of years ago, the president set an aspirational goal that by the year 2013, our retention, our freshman to sophomore retention rate, would be at 85%. I say aspirational because we're not quite there yet. We're going to give you those rates in a few minutes. And one of the things that we want to do today in our discussion is talk about ways in which we can all work together to get to that 85%. What can we all do to get there?
You'll see right now we are a traditional selectivity, as our students are above the top 50%, the majority, and then in an 18 to 24 for that ACT composite. So we sit right there. You'll see above us the selectivity and the highly selective are the two categories that are above us. And then you're going to see the benchmark rates. So for our category, 71.5 for a first year retention rate, and then 43.7. You'll notice that the next one, the selective above us, their benchmark is 81.6. So we are aiming to be not only a category higher than our selectivity, but several percentage points beyond that as well. The one thing we want to stress is we are already doing really well. As an institution, because of how we say we are in our personalization, it comes through in the fact that our retention and our graduation rates are where they are. And so it is a big aspirational goal to move to that 85%. And so beyond doing the above and beyond we already do, we're going to have to just kick it up a notch to get where the president would like to see us. But everybody should pat themselves on the back. Hooray, we're way above the benchmarks, which looks great, getting back to the provost's conversation about recruitment. Parents love to hear that, those numbers as well.
Okay, so that is where we are compared to the national numbers and our selectivity. Here are 10 years worth of data for our retention rate. You can see that we've been pretty steady from 78%, to a high of 82% in fall of 06 to 79%. So we're from 78 to 82% over the last 10 years for an average of 79.4% freshman to sophomore retention rate. So we have 6% to move up to get to the 85%. The graduation rates, this is the most up-to-date data that we have, from 61 to 60 to 56 to 58. We had a little dip there. Hopefully we're back on our way up, and we will continue to see those graduation rates at above a 60%. But that's where we are right now for the last 10 years. Now, we've also looked at graduation rates across the state and looked at other Illinois public institutions and where they are. We've given you here the last 3 years, the most up-to-date graduation rates. Remember, this is a six-year graduation rate, okay, for all the other Illinois schools. And I'm not sure if this is too small for you to see, so I'm just going to kind of read it very quickly. The orange, the very first one, is the University of Illinois at Champaign-Urbana. They're at 83, 82. We are next in line there with the bright blue, the EIU blue, 58, 56, 60. Yellow is Illinois State, 69, 70, 65. Several years ago, some of you may have been at a retention forum and we said, we're number two. They're now number two. So they have surpassed us a little bit in terms of graduation rates in the last few years. The green is Northern, 48, 51, 52. Western is the Lavender, 59, 55, 57. Southern at Carbondale is the red, 44, 45, 46. University of Illinois at Chicago is the purple, the violet, 54%, 48%, 50%. So you can see that these other fine institutions, most of them are still below Eastern. University of Illinois at Springfield is the, I skipped Edwardsville. That's the teal, 46, 49, 45. The purple is University of Illinois at Springfield. They have had a weird giant leap from 2002 to 2003 of a 10 percentage points in their graduation rates. Not sure what happened there, but they went from 57 to 67. Percent.
It's pretty unusual.
Yeah, it is. I think we need to go spy on them and find out how they moved 10% in a single year. And then we also added on here, just for the comparison of another institution, Indiana State is the light blue. And that's 41, 44, 42%. So you can see our graduation rates are very good, but again, it wouldn't hurt for us to be able to bump those up a little bit. And better retention leads to better graduation rates. Okay, we promised you some alumni survey data, and I'm just going to very quickly explain. The retention committee looks at all these hard numbers. Well, we also look at the comments that the students make on the alumni survey. This is the IBHE mandated survey we send out every year. This is data from 2010, and we sent that to 1 year out. So the 2009 graduates, every person who graduated in the calendar year 2009 got this survey. 774 of them returned it for a 35% return rate. And we ask them, what had the most positive impact on you during your time at Eastern? And then what had the most negative impact on you during your time at Eastern? This is, qualitative data. It takes a while to figure it out and sort it all out, but this chart represents that sort. Of the positive comments that students made, 53% of those were related to their relationships with faculty and advisors. So going back to what the president and the provost said in the opening, that personal relationship, that one-on-one that we can give to our students, they remember. Okay. The negative comments, the highest was also those personal relationships. But I'd like to point out, a lot fewer people had negative things to say. And that's one of the heartening things about the alumni survey data. The comments, by the way, are available on the assessment website. If you want to go look and read for yourself, have at it, because they're up there. And they are not edited, so there you have it. The next positive thing are programs. That is their major field of study, their education, their degree. So programs are very important. Social is third. Okay. Now, we're not surprised by that. The social category includes things like the Greek organizations, their friendships. Sometimes people say things like, I met my future wife there, you know, so we'll give them that. Okay. 14% is the co-curriculum. Athletics, recognized student organizations, things they've gotten involved in on campus. So I still think this is a very high number for those positive comments. Okay? 10% of our students said positive things about the community. Those are usually comments like, everybody was friendly there. It was a very close campus. Everyone was approachable. Now, we get more negative comments about that, and it usually involves things like restaurants and shopping. And we all know we are in a small town, and we have those challenges. But the positive comments, I think, are very important. The second category there for negative are programs. We usually see on 1 year out, some people still mad about having to get a waiver for this or that or something like that. But still, their education, the academics, and the relationships with all of you are the things that have the most impact.
We said we'd share some NESI data. So this is the first time that Eastern has participated in this survey, which is looking to measure the engagement as students view their engagement here on campus. So we're going to share two slides. This first one comes back to how did they feel about their overall entire education experience here on campus. And so we're looking at it, what the seniors said. So these are seniors that took this last spring. And so we're going to benchmark ourselves against the other Illinois publics, our Carnegie class, and then all NESI is what you're going to see in the four categories. The top bar is the excellent category and then works its way down. So you can see 1% poor. I think that's phenomenal. absolutely phenomenal. But you can see as we move across, our 6% said fair. So if we say 7 are in the, I always call it like the bottom two boxes, you always want to be in the top two. As we compare ourselves across, you can see other Illinois publics are at 14%, 16 for our class, and then 13 for all others. So we are significantly rated higher by our students comparable to all other classes. So we're really excited to see that and have that match up against our alumni data as confirmation as well. Here's the second one, and it says, would you do it again? Would you come back and do it all over again? And so you're going to see, again, definitely yes is at the top, 55% saying definitely yes, 35% saying probably yes, probably no, 7% and no, I'm not coming back to you at 3. So 90% of our students are reporting, absolutely, I'm coming back to have that experience again. And as we move across, you can see 16% would not return to Illinois publics, 20 to the classification, and 18 to other NESI. So again, finding ourselves above the benchmark numbers, which we're really excited about as well.
So there are several questions on the NESI that ask students about how many hours do you spend in a typical 7-day work week doing the following activities. And so we took all of those activities and put them on the same chart so we could see where students' time is going. The blue line with the box on it is how many hours a week do you spend working for pay on campus? So you can see about 77% aren't working for pay on campus of our seniors, We have the data for our freshmen, too, and we've done some comparisons there. But we wanted to just look at the seniors. The red line there is about how many hours are you working for pay off campus at a job that is off campus but probably in the same town. Dependent care is the green line with the triangle on it. Okay. And that is defined as caring for your children, spouse, or parents. And then in the co-curriculum is the purple line with the X through it. Okay. So how many hours a week are you putting in on athletics, your recognized student organizations, band? Okay. Your social life is the teal line with the star in it. And we could see a little peak there on the social life, that, you know, going to parties, going to movies, you know, playing games on your computer, entertainment, all of those kinds of things. How much time, the orange line, how much time are you spending a week commuting? You can see most of our students are counting, you know, walking to class, walking between classes, walking back to their apartments and residence halls. But it's less than 10 hours a week in that commute. And then the line that will make some of you sad, the light blue line, how much time do you spend a week studying? Studying is defined as working in labs, writing papers, reading your textbook, doing homework, anything associated with academics that do not take place in the classroom. And you could see no one said they were spending 0 hours, but the highest percentage, a little over 50%, are spending less than 10 hours a week on the studying. So probably a little work could be done here in terms of encouraging our students to spend a little more time on the studying. Okay. At least as much time studying as they are commuting would be nice. And the commuting is still a little higher than the study line. Okay, as Kimberly said at the beginning, we wanted to let you know that CORE doesn't just sit around and look at numbers and make pretty charts, although that's one of our favorite parts. But we've basically got several subcommittees. We're going to talk about three of those subcommittees today that are working on initiatives and have been for the past couple of years. We didn't just throw this away. Couple of years. So the first one we're going to talk about is the continuing students. So students who have come here, we want to keep them, and how do we make sure that we keep them? One of the things we started looking at was when our students are registering. And about a year and a half ago, we saw that in finals week, we still had several hundred students who had not yet registered for spring semester. And so panic ensued, and we're like, we're going to have like a 60% retention rate, and it's going to be terrible. And so we decided to start looking at that. So we've been sending out email reminders to students, hey, you need to register. If you have a hold, here are some things you can do to clear that up. Have you not seen your advisor yet? Here's, you know, you need to get your PIN from your advisor. Here's how to do that. And then at the end of the semester, we started sending out surveys because we wanted to know, if they're not coming back, where are they going? What are they going to be doing? Or have they just not gotten around to it yet? So we set up an email survey that we sent out after grades came in so we could remove students that we invited not to return who were dismissed in a given semester. And we've been looking at all of that data. Okay. We have also sent the list of students who are not registered to their department chairs. We say, hey, here are your majors who have not yet registered. Do with this information what you will. And they have reported back to us that they are doing a variety of things dependent upon the major, how many students they have. Some of them are making phone calls. Hey, you need to come in. You skipped your advising appointment. Or you need to come in and talk to us if you're thinking about making any changes to that schedule that we talked about back in September. Some of them are sending out emails, again, to their students. And let's face it, an email from a faculty member in their department or from their chair has more weight than something that comes from CORE. Okay. Some of them are having face-to-face discussions. Some of the smaller departments are seeing students in the hallway and saying, hey, you, you're on my list. Why have you not registered yet? Come see me. Let's talk about your schedule. So those are some of the things that the Continuing Student Initiative is doing.
And so one thing that CORE has been talking about and we're working towards right now is trying to put together a strategy for students that we're going to deem as financially at risk. You know, we have our academically at risk. Now we're going to look at them at financially at risk. And so we are looking at that in a variety of things. Have they paid off their bill? What's the gap between their financial need and what they've been able to receive, those types of things. And so this subcommittee right now is working on trying to put together what that might look like, both educationally, how we connect to them, if we do connect to them, who should we send them to for help. But probably the biggest thing we've been working on is how to notify students earlier about holds. We do know that when we put the financial hold on, a number of them will get in the next 2 weeks and take care of that, and it lifts. And we find ourselves looking at December, you know, kind of those last couple weeks before the end of the semester, really with the number of students that really are in a situation where they have just a financial gap and they're struggling to figure out how to pay off that bill. And so what we're looking at is trying to get really good, accurate data about that, how much it is. And then the one thing we're going to launch this semester is a survey out to those students saying, we know you're not registered. We're pretty sure it's because you have a hold. You know, how do you think you're going to move through handling these finances? And then if what they could use as help. And so we're just in the part where we're trying to gather some additional information so we can build a strategy to help students that are in this situation.
As Kimberly suggested, it's kind of a no-brainer. Students who are not doing well academically don't always stick around to graduate. And so our academic at-risk students are the most endangered around campus because they are the ones that probably aren't going to be retained. In fact, there's about a 20% gap between the students who are academically at risk, not doing well academically, and the average freshman to sophomore retention rate. So one of the things that CORE has done is set up a definition for the at-risk student. Are there things that we can tell when they're coming in or very early on in the process related to whether they're going to succeed? And so we've set six bits of criteria that we're looking at. The first is some of our minority students have lower retention rates than our Caucasian students. It's just a fact that the numbers bear out. Our minority retention rates are lower. Are they a first-generation student? That's another risk factor. Are they the first in their family to go to college? Sometimes that means they don't have the support they're going to need at home. Sometimes it means they don't have the guidance in their family to make it through those 4 years. Sometimes it means the family's going to be pulling at them to keep coming home and transfer to a school that may be closer by where they can live at home. So all of those factors can play into that first generation. Do they have an ACT score below a 21? Okay. If so, they may have trouble with academics here in college. They may struggle. Do they have a high school GPA below a 2.75? We know that the national data suggests that from a high school GPA to a college GPA, the drop is going to be about half a grade, so 0.5. So if a student has a 2.75 and that drop occurs, they're at a 2.25. They're dangerously close to not good academic standing. Okay. Are they undeclared? If they don't have a goal, if they don't have a purpose, they don't have a reason for being here, they don't know what they're going to do in 4 years, that's a risk factor. They haven't made a connection, perhaps, with the department. They're not sure why they're taking all these classes. They may depart. And then, do they have a high financial need? And so if you put more than one of these factors together, the students and the attrition danger increases. Okay? And a student with all of these is the very top of the danger list. So one of the things that the provost has asked us to focus on is an early alert system. And so we have started thinking about, okay, what are the signs for at-risk students? What might we be looking at in various ways for an early alert system? And these are some of the signs that all of you may have seen in your classrooms, in your residence halls, in your offices. Okay. Poor classroom attendance is at the top of that list. A lot of the national experts are saying students who don't go to class are at risk of not being retained. They're not engaged. They're not taking it seriously. Okay. They may have their attention elsewhere. Does not participate in class discussions or complete work on time. So if they just sit there with their head on the desk, they never turn anything in, those are signs that they're at risk. Maybe they're struggling with the coursework. They're turning things in, but they're getting bad grades early on. They're not prepared when they come to class. They don't bring books and pencils and paper and all that stuff that they might need to take notes and engage in what's going on in the classroom. Okay. In the residence halls, you may see a student sleeping a lot, right? Students next door neighbors, if you're an RA or an ARD or an RD in the residence halls, student who's just sleeping the day away. Changes in appearance or demeanor can be an at-risk signal. They may be partying too much, they may be depressed, they may be homesick. If students never appear to be studying, you see the student all the time, they never have books with them, okay? They never seem to be doing anything in an academic nature. Excessive drinking and partying, of course. Going home every weekend, okay? And that's a signal that they're not connecting here, they're not getting engaged, they're not making friends, okay? Their life is back at home. If they aren't making friends, they always seem to be alone. They don't seem to be in groups. Okay? They're not engaging in social activities. If you see homesickness, or they tell you they're homesick, okay, those are at-risk signals.
Okay, so this is the participatory part, which I'm excited because I like to sit down and listen to what somebody else has to say, instead of keeping hearing Carla and myself.
Although we are fascinated.
So here's our question, and what we really need is to have a discussion as a group about how do we take what we each see as risk factors and figure out a way to funnel that into some sort of system that would alert so that we could then get the help to the students that need it. So we match up what they need with who can help them, so we can get them back on track. So that's the big overarching goal for the rest of this conversation. So what we want to do is break out and do a couple things. So the first question we want to talk about is what can each of us do to identify a student that might fall into an at-risk category? And there's going to obviously be other things beyond what we've identified as ways you know they might be at risk, and we want to hear what you think those are as well. And then secondly, what would you be willing to do or participate in at an institution-wide level to indicate the students at risk? What kind of system? What would you actually be willing to do if in your head it was like, I know that student's in danger, somebody should know? What would you then be willing to do to indicate that so that we can build a system that people will actually utilize? CORE doesn't want to spend a lot of time building something that then only we participate in. Because that won't get us anywhere. So those are the two big questions that we want to be able to do. And then the last one we want to talk about is what's one thing inside whatever unit you're a part of, whether it's an academic department, a student affairs or student services office on campus, what's one thing your unit could do in the next year that would help us raise the retention rate? It could be as small or as large as you wanted to tackle, but what's one thing you guys could go back and in the next 30 days say we could do that and start thinking about how to employ that? So those are the two things that we want to talk about for the next little bit. And then we're going to get together, share some of that information with the group as well, and then start talking about what's next and where we are going to go with that. Do the questions that we're asking make sense? Okay. So how we want to do this is we're going to kind of break out by what kind of role we have on campus so that we can have these conversations better, because obviously this would be a big room to have that kind of conversation. So now what we'd like to do is just hear maybe a couple highlights from each group about your discussion. Obviously, the core members that were in there, we're going to compile everything that was discussed and talked about. But we're just going to kind of talk about what happened in each group and see if we can find some common themes or some common understanding, and then we'll keep moving from there. So if I might be so bold, Patty, would you mind starting and talk about...
I had the group of undergraduates and grad students, and what was interesting is their area is counseling and student development and housing and student affairs, so they already have a heart for caring anyway, so that was kind of exciting. One of the things that they said from their side is identifying at risk is they really look at behaviors, and particularly isolating behaviors. From their standpoint, they sort of go through their courses in cohorts. And so when they see students that isolate themselves at breaks or before and after class, that's a red flag for them, that they realize that, I think somebody said, I think it was Fred that said, everybody likes to, if there's one thing they like to do in grad school is complain about grad school. And if they won't even engage in that, then they know that things are a challenge. Those with assistantships felt that the assistantship helped them stay engaged. It gave them a support group that our graduate students without an assistantship are not able to get, or it's much more difficult for them. And the one thing that they felt could be changed is that perhaps at the graduate school level, and I'm paraphrasing here, but maybe part of orientation, but that there be some, and in the departmental graduate programs, looking at ways to build cohorts. And that it's a challenge for some of those programs that are evenings only, weekends only, they're off campus, but to really build a sense of community so that when you see somebody that's struggling, you can ask. And that was, I said, what can you do? And they said, you ask. But you have to feel comfortable enough to ask, are you okay? And so for them, it was about making the connections. And they were all willing to do that. But then the question came up, what about at the undergrad level? How can we help build cohorts for our undergrads? And then we ran out of time. So thank you for asking me to work with them. It was great.
Thanks, Patty. Jody? He's behind
Jody's
you.
Behind you, Chad.
Okay, our group for the campus-wide activity, we talked about creating a campus-wide mentoring program.
No, it's just for the podcast.
It's just for the podcast.
Okay. Thanks, Lynette. Also, have a central place for employees and staff to go to find resources for students, which led into finding a tracking system, possibly in Banner, for staff and faculty to be able to input early warning signs or to identify at-risk students immediately so that we can share that resource with one another. I think Mississippi State might have a similar type of system. There were a couple concerns with that. One, concerns about possible liability, student confidentiality, and then also to protect the trust that the student has developed with that individual who's reporting them at risk. So those might be some things we need to consider. And then we also went on to talk about finding an easy way for students to report on their peers, to encourage students to provide resources or address, or what's the word I'm looking for, lead other students to the areas that they need, whether it's an academic issue, financial issue, whatever those might be.
I worked with the academic advisors in departments and in our academic advising center, and what we looked at were, what were some signs that we saw when we might think we have an at-risk what are some things we would do. We talked about more communication. We said if we see that we have a student that is having a problem, then maybe you can call that student in or you can ask that student, are there different, you know, programs that you need to be involved in, know the resources that are available, what you can refer students to. They said really just like intrusive advisement, just making sure that they are in contact with that student and they have information to give out to the students. If they need to go to, and we talked mostly about those that are undeclared majors, so, you know, maybe send them to career services, have them do shadowing, maybe take some courses that they might have likes for. So really it was the intrusive advisement and communications. They said another thing that they think would be good, not sure what the overall faculty would think about this, is instead of doing the midterm grades, do quarterly grades. A lot of our freshmen that are coming in are, you know, really, really, I don't want to say that they don't truly understand what it is to, you know, be failing a class. They think that they go all the way through until midterms and thinking that they get an A in a class, and somehow when they get that midterm grade and have an F, not understand what happened. And so if we had quarterly grades, then it would be easier for them to be realistic with what they are going to get. They also talked about an early alert system. Yolanda spoke when she was at Temple. There was a system that they have, and maybe it can go through Banner, where every time they met with someone, they documented that information, they put it in the system, and the student would also get that email that says, you know, you saw Yolanda on January 5th, and if Yolanda made a referral and said you need to go to career services or you need to go to the math tutor, once that math tutor, then they put that documentation in there, and so then that student will, I mean, really be, you know, aware of all of the help that they've tried to get, and then maybe it'll be a little bit easier for them. So pretty much the early alert system, the quarterly reports, and then just intrusive advisement.
I worked with a faculty group. We spent most of our time talking about what faculty are already doing to identify at-risk students. And not surprisingly, the methods are basically two. They look at attendance and they look at performance. And so attendance takes the form of actually tracking attendance, sometimes using it to figure grades, not allowing students to make up work when they don't come to class, which then is sort of an incentive for them to get there. Some folks actually take attendance, identify students to their chairs if they have excessive absences, and the chairs help follow up. That can be a big help as well. In terms of the performance, though, sometimes they're just very basic methods too. One instructor reported, for instance, that when a student gets an especially low grade on a quiz or a test, the student gets a big red number circled on the exam, and that's the clue to the instructor that this student has to follow up with him. And so the student knows, if I perform poorly, I have to go see my teacher. And if the student doesn't show up, the teacher follows up with the student until he or she does. But this particular instructor also reported on a technique that I think is useful. It's simply being aware of students who have questions, who obviously have questions during class time but aren't asking them, and drawing them out so that they get the information they need to understand the assignment and move on and so forth. We didn't have a lot of time to talk about the early warning system, but there did seem to be some support for something that would be simple, attached to Banner or PAWS, a system that we're already using so that instructors could indicate when students have excessive absences. This information would then go to somebody else who would follow up, and it could be a combination of somebody's. It could be the advisor, it could be residence hall staff, it could be somebody in the Student Success Center. But there are all kinds of possibilities there.
Thank you, Mary. We want to thank you all for coming. We want to make sure we collect your green cards. As a wrap-up, I want to say this is the beginning of the discussion. It's not the end, and we've certainly not found the perfect solution to getting to that 85%. 100% retention rate by 2013. But I want to encourage all of you to communicate with us if you have good ideas. We are starting a new newsletter called Retention Matters. Ba-dum-bum. You know, we think it's kind of funny. Some of the data and information that we have shared with you today will be in the first issue of the newsletter. We have a stack of them outside. So as we're wrapping up and finishing, we'd like you to pick up a copy. We'll be circulating those campus-wide in the next few days, but you get the early edition. But you will be hearing more from CORE about some of these initiatives, and we will be asking for your help in participating in whatever early alert system we put together. We may be asking more information in terms of, okay, what are you really willing to do? Maybe doing a short survey. And I know that you will be asked, what can we do locally in your department, in your unit, in your particular office? And, you know, I would just encourage everybody to realize that every encounter you have with a student is part of the retention process. Every conversation, every email, every encounter in the hallway, every day in class is part of our retention efforts. So it doesn't have to be a big, huge, expensive thing. It may be those little touches. We already know, we have the data that shows that personal experience is what makes our alums happy. That's why they come here. That's why they're satisfied alums. That's what our seniors said on the National Survey of Student Engagement. Okay? So we know we've got that going for us. We may need to just increase that a little bit and keep looking for ways to make a smooth transition from matriculation to graduation and try not to throw up any obstacles unwarranted in a student's path. And so CORE will be looking at all of those kinds of things. Every issue of the newsletter is going to have a spotlight on, and a spotlight on a program that's doing something related to retention. And so if you have ideas for that, let one of us know, because we would love to spotlight your program. There's also a CORE Corner where we can keep you up to date on what we're doing and ask for your feedback. Okay. And the first newsletter has an article directed specifically at the faculty. What can you do in your classroom, in your office, to aid in students' retention and ultimately their success here? Okay. Any last words? Anyone? Blair? Okay. Thank you all for coming.
We're going to take your green cards, everything we gathered up here. The committee is going to be re-looking at that. We're going to push it out to the website. But we have all your emails, so you might get a question from us about what you meant or asking us to help. So be on the lookout for that as well.
Because we know who you are. Thank you.